November 14th is World Diabetes Day. And this year, to commemorate this day, we have a specialist with us that is ready to answer all your questions about diabetes. Let's welcome Dr. Kurubo. He's a top tier consultant, endocrinologist, and diabetologist. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Yemi. It's great to be here.
How are you, sir?
I'm good. Thank you.
Awesome. So guys, we asked you for questions, everything that is bothering you, your worries and fears about diabetes, so that he could answer them. And I want to say thank you very much for sending your questions. I'd like to say, first of all, that these are the questions and he has not seen them. So we're going to be actually getting, you know, first-hand reaction to your questions, okay? So I've already grouped the questions so that we can have some semblance of order. So sir, can you give us like a brief overview of diabetes and how common it is?
So diabetes is a condition in the body where your sugar in your body is higher than it should be, very high. High sugar. And this high sugar, normally in our body, a chemical called insulin brings the sugar down, controls how the sugar is high or low in our body. Okay. In diabetes now, this insulin is either not there at all, or it is there and it's not working. So you end up having high sugar because insulin is either not there or not working at all. The high sugar stays now in our body and begins to cause many problems. It can affect our brain, our eyes, our kidneys, our nerves. Also in our body, this insulin that is not working well or not there at all now gives the body difficulty to manage carbohydrates, fats, and protein. This is important because previously people thought that diabetes is a carbohydrate sickness. And I try to remind people now that no, in diabetes, the body will not manage carbohydrates well. It will not manage fats well, it will not manage protein well. And if something is not done on time, it can result in permanent illness or even death. Now, for how common diabetes is, what we do is every 2 years, we gather information from all over the world, and that gives us an idea of how many people are living with diabetes. As of now, 2021, our atlas is out, called IDF Atlas, 10th edition. It tells us that over 537 million people have diabetes as of today. The other problem is that 81% of these people, that is, if you see 5 people that have diabetes, 4 of them live in countries where there's no money. Or money is there and it's not being used well. 4 out of 5 people you see living with diabetes. Yes, of 2021, 6.5 million people have died already. What that means is that every 5 seconds, one person dies from diabetes and its complication. In America, where they keep money for health, over $900 billion has been spent on diabetes over the past 15 years. $900 billion. So what this means is we have a condition that is affecting everybody in the world, a condition that is rising every year. It is rising. A condition that is now selectively attacking people without money or proper health care program. And even in countries like America, they are spending billions of dollars. This is diabetes.
Thank you so much, sir. The next question is, what exactly causes this diabetes?
You know, like diabetes results from a problem, like I did mention earlier, where a chemical in the body called insulin is either not there or it's not working. We have observed that diabetes is not one illness. Some people have a type of diabetes where they don't have insulin at all. What has caused diabetes in those people is a damage in their body. Their own body attacks a factor called the pancreas and scatters insulin, so there is no insulin in them. We've noticed that another set of people, they have diabetes because they inherited it in their family. Different people in their family have a problem with the way the body handles sugar. And these people will have insulin initially, but it is not working. In some people, we have observed that their diabetes results from drugs they take. These drugs could be from high BP, it could be for cancer treatment, it could be that they are receiving treatment for HIV. So these people, these drugs they take, increase their chances of developing diabetes. Other people get diabetes because of an infection. There are infections. There are some big medical terms, rubella infection, Coxsackie B infection. All these organisms attack the factory called pancreas where insulin is produced and damages it. Now, we have also observed again that some other people develop diabetes because that factory, there is a problem, an illness in the factory, and as a consequence of the factory going on strike, insulin is not produced and they have that. Others we have observed is that women know diabetes, but when pregnancy comes, their body doesn't manage the sugar well. And this now causes a special, you know, women are special. So we have a special category for women in pregnancy with diabetes, and that one we call gestational diabetes. You see, the essence of this is that because you are not dealing with one illness, the causes differ. So also will the treatment differ. So also will the prevention differ.
Does diabetes affect young people?
Fantastic. Now, first of all, our definition of young is somewhere between 18 years, you know, young, 18 to about 25, or even younger, like children, infants. Diabetes can affect children that are 1 year old.
1 year.
1 year old baby can develop diabetes. Diabetes cannot affect children up to around age 5-6. Then we notice that you may not see children around that age having diabetes again. And then later on, around age 12, 13, 14, diabetes comes up. The one that affects 1 year old children, we observed that the body attacks the factory called the pancreas. The organ, the pancreas is an organ, and it is attacked by the body, and eventually it damages the pancreas. Now, however, because of childhood obesity, where children are bigger than they ought to be for that age, the weight and the height, they are bigger. This childhood obesity is making us see what the type of diabetes we used to think that you see only in adults, what we call type 2 diabetes. We have seen it in 2-year-old children, 3-year-old children, because of childhood obesity. You know that the childhood obesity now is on the rise. There are many factors. Part of them include socio-cultural factors, where people erroneously believe that having very big obese children is a sign of affluence.
Living well.
And then, of course, if you look at all these schools now, they don't have playgrounds. So children's playground is not there. Exercise is no longer a routine. Physical education has many names, extracurricular activities, and all sorts of technologies. At the end of the day, our children are bigger than they should be. And that now predisposes them, makes their chances of having diabetes increase. So the answer, sadly enough, is yes, diabetes can occur in children, in young people. Any age can develop diabetes. Any age can develop any type of diabetes.
Okay. a youth, even while regularly picking sugar, what are the chances that I'll get it later in life?
That is a very interesting question. I have a patient that developed diabetes when he was 45, and his father at 70 just developed diabetes. So the first thing is that if you have a genetic predisposition, which means your body has a gene that makes you more at risk for diabetes, then other factors contribute. A situation where that person takes sugary drinks and is no with age, is no longer living a very active lifestyle, they don't exercise much and all that, that now predisposes the person, and such a person can develop diabetes later on in life if they have the genes. In simple English, for diabetes to occur, two things must be there. You must have the gene in you, especially for type 2, one, and then two, lifestyle factors. So it is a double hit. Let's say the body is a table. The gene is a crack. If you don't put a weight on that crack, the table will stay. So if you have the crack, which is the gene, and you decide not to exercise, you decide to eat a lot of sugary things and all that, this now is a weight on the table. The table breaks, diabetes comes out.
Nice one. Okay, sir. So yes, there are actually good chances if you don't take proper precautions.
Very important.
Next one. Okay. So I think this one will be very big explaining the last question, but let me just read out. Could one still end up diabetic even after eating healthy and exercising, since it is said to be hereditary?
Yes. So you have to manage everything. Now, in modern day times, one of our focus is how to delay the onset of diabetes. So if you have two people with the same genetic predisposition, or this person eats healthy and exercise, should diabetes come in this person, it will take a longer time. Unlike the person that does not exercise and does not eat healthy. So you can delay the onset and even prevent it if you know what you're doing.
So this person says, how do I know if I have diabetes?
Okay. So you can tell if you have diabetes in two simple ways. The first way is the complaints you come with to the doctor, and then the second way is a lab test. Now, the complaints we come with the doctors, we notice that patients with diabetes we can discover as doctors by three ways. One, the patient can complain of what we call classic symptoms. I'm urinating frequently, I'm always thirsty, I'm always hungry, and I may be losing weight that I don't want to lose. When we say classic, it means that if a patient comes with these three and four complaints, the first thing the doctor should consider then is diabetes. Now, however, we have people that will not complain of frequent urination, frequent thirst. They may come with a stroke. They may come with difficulty in seeing, difficulty in hearing, tooth decay, heart attack, tuberculosis, kidney problem, erectile dysfunction, difficulty in getting pregnant, wound that will not heal. These complaints usually may point to other things, but you must consider diabetes. So remember, the person may not be urinating frequently. These other complaints may be the only thing the person comes with. And then the third and dangerous way diabetes can present is no complaint.
Wow.
That means the person has diabetes. Diabetes is causing all the damage. The person doesn't know. And maybe if the person is lucky, routine medical check, they discover the person's sugar is high. This is serious because right now, 50% of people that have diabetes do not know that they have. 50% do not know that they have. So it's either the person will have the classic symptoms, the non-classic symptoms, or no complaint. Now, after this, a blood test is done. This blood test done is not done with the simple machine we call a glucometer. That machine is not used to make a diagnosis. We use that machine to do what we call screening, medical test. To make the diagnosis, we will draw blood, take it to the lab, use a machine called spectrophotometer, and then we will now use certain numbers. If the person has the classic symptoms and the number is 7 or more, we say this person has diabetes. If you don't have the classic symptoms, we will repeat the test within a week or so. So the message, importantly for this question, is you may come with urinating frequently, thirst, you know, hunger, or you may not come with that at all, and that is missing. Sometimes you may not even have any complaint, but the damage is going on. And at the end, when you go to a hospital, the doctor checks you, blood may be drawn, and it will now be checked to confirm if you are living with diabetes.
There are a lot of things I didn't even know, so I'm actually happy that I've learned all this as well. Okay, so how do you know when a child has diabetes? So this is different.
Yeah, this is a fantastic question. We have put an advisory for parents and general doctors that may see children. Children that have diabetes, a lot of them may not complain of frequent urination, depending on their age. So apart from frequent urination, usually any child that has a sudden illness, most people would think, oh, this is malaria. So you have a child coming with a fever, refusal to eat, excessive crying. What we advise now is, apart from all the intelligent tests you must run, you must check for diabetes. Because in children, diabetes usually would come with sudden severe illness. So how do you know? In colloquial terms, malaria that is refusing to go, amongst many things, could also be diabetes. So every doctor seeing a child, once you have noticed a fever and this child is not eating, crying, it could be many things, but the plea today is check for diabetes.
Thank you so much. The next person says, this diabetes seems to be a big deal. What does it even do to the body? So
the first thing that the person has to appreciate is that everywhere in the world, we have doctors porting to Canada, diabetes is waiting for them there.
Yeah.
There are people that are going to the UK, diabetes. So everywhere in the world, the illness is there. Mm-hmm. That's the first point. The second point is that this is a condition that can affect the brain and result in strokes. It can cause blindness, difficulty in hearing, difficulty in getting pregnant, erectile dysfunction. One of the commonest causes why people lose their leg without being involved in an accident is diabetes. In most places where you see people going for dialysis, where they connect them to a machine to help the body do a few things that the kidney can no longer do, diabetes is the cause. As we sit right now, every 5 seconds, one person is dying from diabetes. If you look at people that die from malaria, tuberculosis, HIV, combined, they are not equal to people dying from diabetes. There is no illness in the world that has sustainably, continuously killed people regularly, if not diabetes. So one out in every 5 seconds, one person is dying. I think that's enough to put attention in diabetes. But however, as we will discover, the story is not also good. Diabetes in 2021 does offer fantastic opportunities.
So we'll get into that later. Alright, wow guys, chills. Oh, okay. This question says, my friend died 2 years ago. After we rushed her to the hospital, the doctor said she must have been diabetic without knowing about it. I don't understand. How did it kill her?
Yes, what happens, like I said, is when somebody has diabetes, they don't know, and they develop an illness like that and you bring them. Diabetes can kill you suddenly from the amount of urination the person you need, the fluid leaves the body and the kidneys can shut down. Diabetes could have killed her suddenly from increasing blood clot in the blood, which can go and block the heart, block the lungs or the brain and cause sudden death. So diabetes could have killed her, but diabetes can also kill over time by damaging the kidneys, destroying the heart over time. So it can kill you suddenly or over time. So the likely cause of the sudden death from that could be from what we call complications of diabetes. And in her case, depending on her age, likely she has something we call diabetic ketoacidosis, which is, if not managed, yes, it's fatal case.
Thank you. Okay, moving on to the next question. Slim persons usually don't have diabetes. Is body size a contributing factor?
Now, surprisingly, slim people can have diabetes. In fact, there is a type of diabetes that we see commonly in slim people. Now, the first thing to say is that when you're overweight or you're obese, the insulin in your body is like a key that opens the door for sugar to enter.
Yeah.
And then it shuts other things in the body. We notice that when you are big, overweight or obese, this key doesn't work well. So obesity and overweight causes insulin not to function well, and yes, can increase diabetes. However, there are people that have diabetes, they are slim, but insulin is not working well or not even there in their body. So slim people can have diabetes. It is commoner in people that are obese, very true, but slim. So again, neither age, nor sex, nor weight can be used to separate patients with diabetes. Okay, so we can divide people that are rich simply. Commonly, if you have somebody living with diabetes in your family, you are at risk. I make it bold to say that there is no family in Nigeria, first or second generation, that doesn't have one person living with diabetes. It's an open challenge. Open challenge. Remember, it means when you go home this Christmas, in the course of killing the goat and the cow, you must ask them, is anybody here living with diabetes? Because you need to do that statistics for me.
Sorry, sir. Guys, can we see your comments down below? Is there anybody in your family that has diabetes?
That you are aware of. This is a challenge.
Okay.
I'm challenging everybody. Check either first or second generation. So first generation would be brothers, sisters, uncle. Cousins, second generation is extended on calls and said, check, you will have one person in Nigeria is a challenge. So the fact that a family member is living with diabetes makes you at risk. Now, if you are overweight or obese, and you know, overweight and obese, we don't do those things by just looking at somebody. These are scientific terms where we take your height and weight and calculate. And if you're overweight or obese, you're at risk. If you do not exercise regularly, you are at risk. For a woman, if you had a baby previously and your baby was very big, that puts you at risk. If you have high blood pressure, so your blood pressure is somewhere around 140 over 80, you are at risk. Lipid problems, cholesterol problems, you are at risk. So you discover, in fact, let me tell you that the American Diabetic Association says that in America, once you have African descent, you are at risk.
Guys, it seems we are all.
And that would be a nice message, we're all at risk. And if we remember we're all at risk, then preventive tips would save all of us.
You're hearing
that.
This is the start of the talks, guys. Okay, the next question. My mother is diabetic, what do I do not to get it? And how do I know that I've gotten it just in case I do?
Okay, so the first one we'll look at is, how do I not get it? One of the things we teach doctors to really mm-hmm. is that when you see one patient living with diabetes, after you've done all your medical magic and you've done, you must teach that person to go back and make sure their children do not develop diabetes. For me as an endocrinologist, that is a key cardinal fact of my care for patients. Mm-hmm. I make sure I talk to the family. And what do we do? The first thing is information that diabetes risk is in the family. So first thing is to disseminate the information. The second thing is to establish simple lifestyle measures, meaning exercise now becomes a family routine. The next thing the person can do is to eat healthy. There is nothing like a diabetic diet. It doesn't exist. You know, before they say, I eat on ripe plantain, eat moi beans, those are prison foods. No. Balanced diet. And if you have one person living with diabetes, the diet of that person is the family diet.
Wow.
So that's the message. Balanced, healthy diet, providing essential nutrients, carbohydrate, fats, food, everything is present in right proportion, right ratio. So if the person exercises properly, the person has the balanced diet, the person will prevent diabetes. Now moving forward beyond that, scientifically also, we have drugs that we can give. So if somebody's at risk, endocrinologists have drugs we give that can help you. Beyond drugs also, for certain unique patients, we even have a particular surgical procedure that can be done to prevent diabetes. So we have moved from lifestyle measures, exercise, diet, tablets exist, and such to prevent diabetes. Now, how do I know if I already have? The person should ask themselves those classic questions, urinating frequently, test, eating, if they already have that. If they don't, they can run certain tests. The fasting plasma glucose, medical test, blood taking when you have eating for at least 8 to 12 hours. That is a test for diabetes. However, in my experience, a lot of Africans, Nigerians especially, may have apparently normal fasting. But if you check their sugar 2 hours after food, sugar is high.
Okay.
Then a test called OGTT, high. And then finally a test called HbA1c. My message is, if you check the fasting and it is normal, I am telling you that from my experience, that is not enough. You must either consider doing an OGTT or HbA1c.
Yeah, hope the person has gotten that message. Move on to the next question. How often should I check my blood sugar? I am not diabetic.
Okay, good. So, a fantastic question. It's a wonderful question. Now, I will give you the layman's approach and the medical approach.
Okay.
Layman's approach is, you don't have diabetes, well, and you've not seen a doctor, so you're not aware of any risk in your family. Check your sugar as often as you do your routine medical checks. So let's say you do it once in 6 months, you do it once in 1 year. We are presuming that in 2021, people know that they should do routine medical checks.
Yeah,
we know that we service our cars.
Yeah.
We service our generators. We should service our body. Now, maybe if the person has seen a doctor and the person has risk factors to diabetes, we now categorize them. Some we tell them do it once in 3 months. Some we say once in 6 months. Some we say once in 1 year. Let me tell you, my father died from complications of diabetes, and that is why I became an endocrinologist, because of my dad. So, because I have the risk, people like me are advised to do it once in 6 months. So, the risk determines. So you now understand my passion for diabetes.
Yes, sir.
So diabetes and I have to war, but I have found a secret that diabetes, rather than the gloomy stories, there lies an opportunity in diabetes. Eventually, everybody will ask me to give them diabetes for that opportunity. An opportunity exists.
Okay,
sir.
All right, then. Guys, so far,
we've
been getting so much information. Okay, I like this question. How come diabetes is hereditary?
Very good. We believe that a long time ago, because of poverty, lack of food, our body adapted to storing food. You know, when you don't have so much, the body now adjusted to be keeping food extra. That gene that makes us keep food extra is called the thrifty gene.
It's called the what?
Thrifty gene.
Okay.
Medical term. So this thrifty gene is now passed from parent to children over time. And we believe that that gene of storing food, not managing it well, has resulted over time to diabetes. So diabetes is inherited because we inherit a particular gene in our body. We are, at the end of the day, 50% mother, 50% father, roughly speaking.
Yeah, I 100% answer.
Then,
what is expected of a diabetic patient?
Well, okay, this will push me to the secret for diabetes. Diabetes, at the end of the day, our innermost desire must be to live long and to live well.
Okay.
Whether you're a Christian or Muslim, it is expected that at least somebody should live to 70 years. It doesn't say you should die at 70. It says by the time you get to 70, you should be hale and hearty. For you to achieve this, you must sleep well, exercise well, eat well, have the right mindset, get medical checkups. The only medical condition that insists that you do this is diabetes. Therefore, if you are living with diabetes and you do the right thing, you will live long and well. And let me explain to you. If somebody has diabetes, one of the first things we do, endocrinologists, is we agree with the patient what you want out of life. You want to live long, you want to live well. We now assess you and say, okay, these are the numbers you must have. Sugar numbers, you must check your morning sugar. After food, you must check HbA1c down every 2 to 3 months. Then you must have your blood pressure at a particular number. The need for you to live with diabetes well, blood pressure should not exceed 130 over 80. You should sleep at least 6 to 8 hours. No stress. When you come for your care, you divide your care into seeing the doctor, coming to the hospital, checking up, and then there's what we call home-based care. What is expected of a patient living with diabetes? So the person must come to the hospital for their visits, get checked, remind the doctor to examine their food. Remember, knowledge, 2021. The doctor is not the one, because some doctors are so busy. A patient living with diabetes must have enough knowledge to say, "Doc, I'm living with diabetes, please examine my food." Immediately you do that, the doctor sits up. Now, at home, what is the prescription for you? First one is L, monitoring. You must have a book. This book will have your date, sugar numbers, the time you took the sugar, and if you're on insulin, the dose. I call this book the Oberon log. The log book, Oberon log book, that has your sugar. So you must keep it. This helps you to know whether you're doing well. You will notice foods that you eat that can affect your sugar, everything visually. The next thing you must do, what should the patient do? You will make sure that you exercise. But before exercising, you will get someone to check your food before and after exercise. So that in case you develop an injury, you will know. Then your food, medical nutrition therapy, eating the right amount, the right way, the right time. And then you must have the right information. And then finally take your drugs. Now, Mimi, I know you cook very well. So if you go pick up chicken, pick up goat, you want to make some nice stew, you've put all the ingredients, and you don't turn on the light, will the food cook? The monitoring of the sugar, the exercise, examining your food, eating right, getting the right information, these are the heat that boils the drugs, the food. If you do not do these things, the drugs will not work.
The drugs will not work.
They will not work. And you see, when patients come to the hospital, the media are looking for a silver bullet. It doesn't exist. So what patients want is, let me take this drug. And I'm saying, no, there is work to be done to eat the meal. You must do these things for the drugs to work. So these are some of the things. You see, we need, the essence is this. If you do these things, you will live with diabetes and live well. You notice that in service the course of our discussion, I have not used the term diabetic. Diabetic patients, that term does not exist anymore. Diabetic patients are patients that are ill, dying, worries me, not in my practice, not in endocrinology practice. We say living with diabetes, like living with a bad wife. You manage, you are aware that you have. you take precautions to keep diabetes under control and you live your life well. So somebody in 2021 that has the right information, right motivation, and doctors that have common sense, we live with diabetes without stroke, without blindness. All those things I mentioned as complications occur when the sugar is not well controlled. They are not a must. So the message of 2021 is diabetes offers now an opportunity for you to live long and live well.
Oh, I see. Okay, yes, because it pushes you to all those
the things you will not do. I mean, let's be honest. How many people on their own would want to exercise? That when you are eating your meal, like you're living with diabetes, timing says breakfast is 7:38, lunch 1:32, and dinner should not exceed 8 p.m. How many people will keep to that? Only the patient living with diabetes will harness enough discipline to do that. Nigerians up till 10:30, 11 p.m., people are eating. The message is that only patients with diabetes will routinely exercise 30 minutes every other day. Only them. Only people with diabetes would know that clinic visits are serious business and they must come with their books stating the Oborok log, sugar, time, drug dose, and complaints. And if you meet a doctor that knows his salt, they will sign and comment on the book. No other medical condition involves that. Well, and finally, if you may permit, the patient must remember that in 2021, we assign roles now in diabetes. The caregiver, you have your own role. The patient, your own role, and the family members. We expect that if you're living with diabetes, what should you do? Come with a family member to the clinic.
Okay.
I don't see patients living with diabetes alone. I have what we call a buddy now. Your family member comes, sits with you, and for everything you are telling me, I look to confirm it. If you are married, better, your spouse comes. Which other condition would somebody be living with where you would take your spouse with you? It will promote bonding, sharing. Do you know the psychological trauma that patients living with diabetes have? To have a medical condition in which your introductory statement is that there's no care.
Wow.
So rather than splitting the home, the fact that the husband and wife in their busy schedule must come to see Dr. Korobo together, their relationship becomes stronger. How about? Tell me you don't want to have diabetes.
So the next question, this person says, can I stop taking my drugs? I was diagnosed with type 2 diabetes within the past year. Can I ever get to a point where I can control my blood sugar, only food and exercise?
Or
do I have to take these drugs for the rest of my life? I am 27 years old.
Okay, well, the first thing to say here is that when you make a diagnosis of type 2 diabetes for a patient, except the patient is critically ill, the usual advice is to start with lifestyle measures and then maybe introduce a drug called metformin. The importance of that is that, first of all, you must end up, you and the patient, will end up appreciating how effective the lifestyle measures are. And then, if drugs are not introduced, the patient understands the importance of why drugs were introduced. I don't know if I'm making it simple enough. Also, that you start drugs and you may stop. There are some patients that will place on drugs and eventually they may reduce either the quantity, the frequency, or even the drugs. That kind of person should see an endocrinologist because there is. We do a lot of assessment. I mean, if somebody has type 2 and at the end of the day, the person's insulin is already finishing. Such a patient would require drugs for a very long time. So if my advice is stay on the path. The lifestyle measures are important. The doctor that gave you the drug likely knew what he was doing, so please take your drugs. And then there will be a need for him to see an endocrinologist or somebody with better knowledge.
The specialist.
And endocrinologist is the best person. Yes.
So please take note of that. The next question, I'm just going to group the next few questions. It's about nutrition and diabetes.
Yeah.
I'll just run through them. The first one, diabetics have a lot of restrictions on their feeding pattern. What are the exact, what's the exact thing they need to eat to stay healthy, besides wheat and less seasoned food and minimize salt intake? So that's one person. Another person says, is it true that plain unsweetened yogurt is good for diabetes? Another person says, is low sugar or zero lactose yogurt good for diabetic patients?
Okay, so first of all, let's answer it clearly. When it comes to using nutrition to manage a medical condition, we call that process medical nutrition therapy, MNT. Now, when we consider nutrition in patients with diabetes, the first thing we consider is what is the amount of calories we want the person to have. Some patients with diabetes need to gain weight. Some will need to lose weight. So we now write that out and calculate how much they need to take to either gain or lose weight. Then we now look at the content. The first important message is that in the content, carbohydrate provides 50% of nutrition. Fats will provide 30% and proteins 20%. I'm saying this because most people think that, food for patients with diabetes doesn't have carbohydrate. That's not true, 50%. Now, for the carbohydrate, we look at quality. Some food, when you eat it, you can taste sugar. Remember that all the food we eat in our body breaks down eventually to glucose.
Yes.
So when you taste sugar in the food, it means that that food, what we call refined sugar, white sugar, was added directly. So patients living with diabetes should not take refined sugars. Yes. There goes their ice creams, soft drinks. That's it, there it goes. So, if you have simple yogurts that doesn't have refined sugars, the answer is yes, that the person can have that.
Okay.
Now, the next thing about the food is, we look at quantity. Usually for patients, we see staple foods like unripe plantain, flour, wheat and all that. And in some patients, even garlic. The staple food should be the size of the feast. The size of the feast tells you the quantity of staple food for basic carbohydrates. This is what vegetables and all that will provide.
Okay.
Protein, this. Fats, this. You see, this is a simple technique to show that you can eat the right food that satisfies you and provides energy based on your size. The other thing to note for the patients is that the food must have variety. It means some patients suffer. It must have variety. So my message to you is that the days of prison, of eating only beans, moimoi, I hereby, by the powers vested in me, in so many prescribing colleges, declare you free.
Thanks.
Good. But the food you must eat sensibly and wisely. And the best thing I do for my patients is I advise you to see an endocrinologist that has training with medical nutrition therapy, or better still, see a dietitian. So the dietitian will sit down with you, plan a meal that satisfies your taste buds, your health, and your pocket.
And your pocket.
And your pocket.
Awesome. Okay, so these three questions have actually been covered. Another one on nutrition. Lesson 6. Nutritionists give recommendations on food not really common in Nigeria. A dietary plan based on common Nigerian meals for a diabetic is scarce. How can we get access?
So this is a good question. I've had this experience in one of my offices in Lagos. And what I always tell them is that we have Nigerian trained dietitians that are trained with our nutrition. And there are a lot of them, from Port Harcourt to Lagos to Ibadan to Calabar, to they're there. So I think that the answer to this question is, one, this food exists. In fact, we have an association for patients living with diabetes called Diabetes Association of Nigeria, DAN.
Okay.
Yeah, Diabetes Association of Nigeria. I happen to serve currently as the National Vice President for the South-South Zone. And in DAN, we have a list, a book, with common Nigerian foods and their sugar contents.
Mm-hmm.
We have them. So this person should see a dietitian trained in Nigeria and should quickly join the nearest Dan chapter, and they will have access to these things.
Mm-hmm.
So they're there.
Awesome. All right, guys, next question. Does diabetes have a definite cure? Another person says, can diabetes be reversed?
So these are two separate questions. So for the first one is a cure. Well, you remember that I told you that diabetes is not one illness.
Yes.
So let's imagine that my diabetes is a result of an antihypertensive I was taking. If I stop that antihypertensive, lucky I'm on time, in quote, you may have almost cured my diabetes. If I had diabetes because of pregnancy, and at the end of the pregnancy, the pregnancy goes, the sugar goes, and I maintain the lifestyle that I was told to maintain, then you've cured me. If I have diabetes because my pancreas, the organ, failed, and I have a transplant, a pancreatic transplant, then you've cured me. So, but for things like type 2 diabetes, it depends, in quote, on how far gone the person is. I'll give a typical example. I have had some patients that are living with diabetes, and they came on time, and we did a procedure called bariatric surgery. A surgical procedure we did in Nigeria where we bypass the stomach or we reduce the stomach or cut part of the stomach away. And we've followed up our patients 4 or 5 years now. They've not been on drugs, they've been on lifestyle measures, and they don't have diabetes. So the cure, in quote, is individualized. It depends on what type you have and when you come. Can diabetes be reversed or regressed? That is an important statement. Again, timing matters. We have patients that come, let's say diabetes is a journey. 0 is when you develop diabetes, and 100 is death. What we have seen, both abroad and in Nigeria, is that most patients, this 0 means that at the point of 0, there is no diabetes, your pancreas is working well, insulin, everything is working well. No patient, and this 100 years, no patient comes to us at 0. All the studies we have done shows that by the time the patients come to us, 50% of their pancreas has gone. And this study we are quoting was done in the United Kingdom, where people have access to healthcare and all that. Our experience in Nigeria is that most of the patients are coming when 60-70% is gone. So that answers part of your question. By the time 60-70% of the pancreas is gone, how do you reverse? So if a patient comes on time, we can reverse. But reverse does not mean cure. Reverse means we get you to a point where you may not need drugs, but you must exercise, you must maintain the lifestyle. Remember that this lifestyle is the simplest way to live long. It's the simplest way. What is the secret of living long? That somebody eats right.
Sleep
6 to 8 hours. I insist on my patients, 6 to 8 hours. That the blood pressure remains okay. That life stress are managed. That the person has a good mindset. This is the secret to life. Whether you go to a spa for body massage, you go to a church for a hope message and inspiration, you go to see motivational speakers, all they are offering you is 1/3 of what endocrinologists will offer you. All they are offering you is the mind. I'm saying that for you to live long, the mind, the body, everything has to agree. And diabetes care is the answer.
Okay, so the next question. How do I prevent my father from an amputation? He has been diabetic for more than 15 years.
Like I did tell you then, that the commonest reason why you see somebody amputated without having an road traffic accident is diabetes. So the first step, the prevention is, the first step is getting the right information regularly, listening to things like this, and you know, keeping abreast with latest developments. The second step is making sure that your father's blood sugar remains within the limits that is normal for him. You see, the sugar numbers are individualized. If I'm living with diabetes and you are living with diabetes, we will not have the same numbers. So we have an individualized sugar numbers. So make sure that his number, his numbers are good. Make sure that you check his leg. Make sure that he does not wear tight shoes. The shoes for a man, the mount of the shoe should be square, not pointed. See my hands. These are the toes. Blood supply to the toes. If the shoe is pointed, this is how it appears. If it's square, this is how it appears. So it makes sense that it should be square. When he wants to wear his shoe, because the nerves may be damaged, you have to take the shoe, turn it upside down to make sure there are no sharp objects inside, so it doesn't get an injury. You want to cut his toenails. You cut it for him because he may not see well. Okay. Use a nail cutter, not a razor blade. And here's a technique. Cut the toenail square, not curved, because you can have ingrowing toenail. Again, diabetes care complete. So if you do these simple things first, you will prevent amputation. You will prevent amputation for the man.
Our next question is, I have been diagnosed with diabetes for over 5 years, and I do not yet have a child. Could they be related?
Now this is the unique thing about diabetes. Most patients may have diabetes, they know they don't know, and in looking for a child, they may present to the gynecologist for fertility issues. Now, for you to get your wife pregnant, or for a woman to get pregnant, the man and the woman must be in good health. Agreed?
Okay.
So let's look at male and female factors. For the man, the factors here is that if you do not manage the sugar well, the man can have erectile problems. And if there's no erection, sex will not occur, and no intercourse, no child. Secondly, the man may have problems with the quality of the sperm and the number of the sperm. So all this can affect. The woman may notice dryness within her. So the man goes in, she screams, he stops, and then it doesn't continue.
No baby.
No baby. And then, of course, hormonal imbalance can occur from poorly controlled diabetes. But now let's reverse this thing. This picture I have painted is for a couple that are living with diabetes without good sugar control, no knowledge. Reverse it to, I am living with diabetes and I'm doing the right thing. I'm monitoring, I'm exercising, I'm going to the hospital. We know that exercise improves fertility. We know nutrition improves fertility. We know good sleep improves fertility. So if you are living with diabetes and doing the right thing, then you may have so many babies that you may not know what to do.
Okay, this person says about diabetes, neuritis, and insipidus. I know insipidus is related to salt and water. Which of them is the insulin shot administered?
Okay, so the term, you know, medicine meaning originated from Latin words.
Okay.
So diabetes means siphon, pouring. So once you say diabetes, it means that plenty urine. Mellitus is sweet. So the person that has plenty urine that is sweet, because in those days they used to test the urine. So as a medical student now, one of the assignments would have been to start testing urine. Perhaps you should introduce that. So mellitus means sweet, while insipidus just means plenty. So therefore, this one that is sweet means there's so much sugar, and that is the one that requires the insulin shot.
Okay, so that's it.
Mellitus.
Right. So this person is asking, I know there is type 1, 2, 4, and gestational diabetes. About gestational, after the mother gives birth, does the diabetes go away or does it remain present?
So the classification the person has mentioned is an adult classification. Now, for WHO, we have so many classifications. Perhaps another discussion. Now, if the woman had 2 gestational diabetes, that means she developed diabetes first time in pregnancy. After she gives birth, we notice that her blood sugar returns to normal. We, however, advise her to keep to the lifestyle things we've told her, because studies abroad showed that 50% of the women, if you have 10 women with gestational diabetes, in the next 5 years, 5 of them will develop type 2 diabetes. However, in our experience in Port Harcourt, it is almost like 9 to 10 of them, nearly 90 to 100% develop.
From gestational to type 2
diabetes? Yes. So the message I'm saying here is that, yes, through gestational diabetes, as the woman gives birth, sugar returns to normal, but life doesn't return to normal. She must keep the lifestyle changes. She must routinely check. If not, the risk of her developing diabetes is high. And remember that the child born from a woman with gestational diabetes in which the sugar was not well controlled in pregnancy, that child has a double risk of developing diabetes younger than his mates. So diabetes, for gestational diabetes, affects the woman, affects the baby when the baby is in the womb, when the baby is born, and as the baby is growing up, there are various complications along the way.
So getting pregnancy is a huge deal.
It is.
Okay, next question please. Can tooth decay be a major manifestation of chronic diabetes in a 54 years old woman?
I had a woman that was brought to my clinic in the hospital. And she went to see the dentist because she had tooth decay and a boil with pus. And the sharp dentist saw that and quickly checked her sugar, and it was 22 millimoles per liter. So remember that when I was telling you how diabetes can present, I mentioned the tooth. So the answer is yes. That patient may not be urinating frequently, may not be thirsty all the time, may not be hungry all the time. And the only way she's known that she has diabetes is going to see the dentist and they check her. Every dentist, when you come to check your tooth, they will screen you for diabetes. Every eye doctor, when you complain of sight, they will screen you for diabetes. Let me say, ophthalmologists, the doctors that handle eye and medical doctors, they screen because they do what is called risk stratification. They look at your age, your family history, they examine you and look at your BMI, and then they put that together and say, okay, let's go.
Yeah, we mentioned 22 millimoles. What's the normal range?
Okay. In checking for diabetes, we use two numbers.
Okay.
And we either use numbers that are single numbers for normal, or we use numbers that are double digits for normal. The single numbers, we normal sugar should be about 3.3 to 5.5 millimoles, millimoles per liter, single numbers. Then, if you use the double numbers, we multiply it by 18. So, you discover that the cutoff for diabetes is 7 millimoles if the person has those classic symptoms one time. And then you repeat it, the person doesn't have 7 millimoles. So, you notice that between 5.5 and 7, there's a huge gap. These people are what we call pre-diabetes. They are in a recruitment ground moving towards diabetes, and they are an opportunity that you can reduce the number of people developing diabetes.
So
5.5 if you're using minimal single digits. Once you use double digits, just apply that, multiply that number by 18. So it's like if you go to Lagos, Lagos numbers are double digits. Port Harcourt, single numbers, and the difference is the units. Single numbers, millimoles per liter, double digits, milligrams per liter. They're just scientific expressive numbers.
Okay. My uncle had a diabetic emergency. What kills diabetes and how do I look out for them?
So patients living with diabetes die from complications. The complications can be sudden or have occurred over time. Usually the sudden complications can be from either high sugar or low sugar. So somebody can have sudden complications of diabetes and is from high sugar and have a condition we call either diabetic ketoacidosis or hyperglycemic hyperosmolastic. These are conditions in which the sugar gets so high, the person loses so much urine, over time it could develop a stroke if it's HHS, or the heart could just fail and they die. Or they could suddenly form very low sugar. There are some patients that have diabetes and because they took the wrong drugs, for example, the wrong time, the wrong way, sugar gets too low and they don't know they could die. Then there are what we call long-term complications. The commonest cause of death for patients living with diabetes is the heart and its association, what we call cardiovascular deaths. Cardiovascular deaths. So the heart fails, sudden heart attack, strokes, kidney problems, sudden necrosis, those are the things that kill the patients. And maybe that is why today, when we are treating patients with diabetes, we are not looking at drugs that just bring sugar. In America, if your drug cannot protect the heart, protect the kidney and the brain, they will not allow you to market the drug. So the attention now is not just sugar and diabetes. This drug can help bring the sugar down, but it can also protect the heart, protect the brain and the kidney, because this is the commonest. These are the commonest causes of deaths in patients living with diabetes.
And getting to the end of our questions. Okay. The last person says, not the last person. The last question is, my father is diabetic and still takes sugary drinks. How do I get him to stop?
That's a good one. You know that one of the most difficult things to do in this life is to alter people's lifestyle, especially when they are of a certain age. So the father would require psychotherapy. And when I mean psychotherapy, I mean sitting down with the father without being judgmental. You are not judging him. You sit down with the father and explain to him the pros and what is right and what is wrong in what he's doing. And offer deals. I'll give you an example. There are some of my patients that have a sweet tooth. So I allow them cheat days. Like I say, once in 2 weeks, you can cheat. But remember that cheat days in quote is better when your sugar has been well controlled over time. So the message for our brother here, sister, is that you must sit with your dad, with a doctor, and talk to him. You cannot judge him. Cannot. Look, it is not difficult. It is very difficult living with a condition that has no cure. I must stress this. It is not easy. So each aspect of care for the patient requires discussion and agreeing. Maybe the era where a doctor sits with a patient and gives commandments has come and gone. You and your patient must agree. So let that patient be brought to a good doctor and let's sit, talk, and agree.
Yeah, this has been a wonderful session. So I don't know if there's something you'd just like to say. And this video should be released on the 14th of November, which marks the World Diabetes Day. And then also, I'd like to say, if you have any other questions, you can leave it in the comment section. They will still be attended to. I'll ask our doctor to still answer all the questions, and I'll send the answers as soon as I can. So is there anything you'd like to
say? I'll just say that diabetes remains a big threat to the world. It is increasing everywhere in the world. It's spreading out of control. Diabetes is out of control. And maybe if we manage diabetes well, we will be able to use our resources well. Because to care for patients with diabetes means you're going to put money and resources into diet, into providing play packs, exercise, into psychological support for our patients, into preventing deaths from stroke, heart attacks, and kidneys. So diabetes can answer more than 70-80% of the health issues. The issues people have amongst the health workers will end, because diabetes is one care where roles are clearly defined. Diabetes does that. But the sad part means that as of 2021, how many people have access to good quality diabetes care? Care for diabetes should begin at the primary health care level and then secondary health care. So I'll ask you a simple question. In 2021, if not now, with all we've achieved in science, and people cannot have access to diabetes care, then when? Thank you.
Just for thoughts, guys. To round up this episode, guys, I'd like to have a special guest here say something.
Please like this video and subscribe to this YouTube channel.